Jalgaon.
Next will be taken by Chhatra.
Next one. As you can see, this is a study that has been done by India Law Association, and many of people have already joined them. So let me just brief about the implementation in India. This is the global chart, and as you can see, it has been adopted worldwide. So the next slide is about its adoption in India. We all over here are coming about it. The first three presentations were about it. So I won't get into this. What we actually intend to do, and even had a question like why are we like switching towards trying to make town planning based on BIM? Basically what we want, what we experience from interventions and all. This are a few things. Like first of all, if you head towards the low areas of Pune, which are very highly dense, like Sadashiv, Kumba and all. On those areas you will find housing and all, but people are fighting and scratching, down every single square and that they can find out. And they are not doing this illegally. They are having legal evidences for these things. And they are using the governmental stuff, like the planning papers and all the sanctioning documents that are being used. They have been like using it because it's having a low level of detail. With BIM we are having a low level of detail in the expression of the concept, what the building is and how the project is going to appear like. So the next part is, this is actually going to resolve a lot of issues in the cities that we have right now. Like the legal construction, we heard about PMC breaking down buildings near Kumbha, and in many areas we had case studies of those things. Next part is resources. Once we have BIM into place, and if all the town planning activities are being done by using BIM platform, we'll have a lot of data. The government will have a lot of data. They'll have the, if the model is of high level of detail, as we had a debate about that just a few minutes ago. If the data is available on a huge magnitude, the more the merrier. So if you're having, suppose a house is to be built, it's having this many type of fans or lights or not, its energy consumption is of this type. That multiplied by the entire city, that's going to give a crazy amount of idea to the government or the authority that's going to regulate the power supply, water supply, and sanitation. So this is the first part, this is resource management, disaster management. This is one thing that we Indians are extremely bad at, disaster management. We never take this. Let me ask you, has NICMAR ever conducted a disaster management earthquake drill or anything? They might have conducted, I'm not a student here. So let's forget that. Next is disaster management. With BIM, we can have an analytical model of the project itself. And while sanctioning, that model could be run against the different scenarios. If you have multiple cities, we have the IS codes that actually govern the steel design and all the kind of things. We can incorporate those. I won't get into those details. But we can incorporate those details into the model itself. And this is done on a large scale in data that could actually help us in town planning. In Japan, they actually have a chart for this kind of things because they usually have earthquakes, so they have charts, they have maps which are actually marked with houses or properties that are going to get damaged earlier. So in that, using those maps and charts, they actually deploy their disaster management things. There is a kind of hospital or anything kind of things. So next part is town planning and regulatory. I'll just explain this later on. I don't have that much time. Next is answering the initial why. Actually, you might have seen this first slide, the big question mark. The answer comes over here. So, how can we implement AI? Why are we trying to make people do things? It's like a CAD drawing works fine, you know, for small projects. For people who are having like budget from someone. CAD drawing works out fine. But why do we need BIM? Because it provides high money. That's useful in if you have kind of dispute arbitration and all. So that will provide you a point. Suppose this is over here, this is my building's GPS coordinates or the co-powers and all. That could be perpetrated anyway. That could be happening. Next, let me tell you about how we have actually prepared a kind of a flowchart, how the process should work. That's according to me. I'll be glad to accept input from you. Proponents will submit their models for sanctioning. It will be to the PMC server, any kind of blockchain or the crypto. We need to maintain privacy. The models will be reviewed by the authorities. like the there we as the engineer sanctioner right now does is he checks the model not the scale of the model submitted, scale and volume of model. Small models, big models, all kind of models, the number, the entire the population of Pune that's going to submit their models. Next is we trigger a kind of algorithm that will actually learn what kind of models these are and what kind of response that person or the checker is providing to that models. So this algorithm will actually kind of build a neural network that will boil down into its own database. So the algorithm can be triggered to learn the model and submit model submitted and responses accredited. Finally, with sufficient sample space. So let me tell you, if I have a lot of data about a person, what Facebook did today, we have Donald Trump as a president of the US, for example. With big data, we can actually automate the entire process of town planning and city planning. Not exactly right now, but in a couple of years. As you've seen, India is adopting BIM. It's not no longer a foreign terminology for us. You know, BIM, though we work for foreign clients, but I can see just a few slides back, you might have seen the map of India with a few big dots on the right side that actually display a big project that are being implemented using BIM. So, yes, if suppose PMC is having 1 lakh proposals to be sanctioned every year, the AI can learn using 1 lakh proposals and can use that learning program. This can be used, suppose town planning is not an easy task. The person who does gets a lot of amount, lots of salary for that purpose. So that can be mitigated, and in that case you can use this, and the problems that we had with AutoDCR, these are the lessons that we could learn from those and implement it. The big file now, the file is not easy. Getting a project sanction is not an easy task in Pune itself. If you are trying to get yourself, you are trying to build your dream home, you need to get through a lot of licensing and bureaucratic stuff. So if you have a centralized process in this case, you will have less costs, less time lag. Less costs, why? Because I personally witnessed this thing while I was an intern. If you are going for any kind of completion checks, like a plinth certification and all kind of things, there are chances that the person who is coming to check would acknowledge that the thing you have shown on the plan is correct, and he may try to persuade you for some kind of corrupted things. So, better resource allocation and utilization, as I explained earlier, and better town planning, better control. It's like the DNA that we get from people and regulate the DNA itself. By using AI and algorithm. So eradication of corruption and malpractice, cost efficiency and all, and the operating cost. So yeah, thanks for having me. Any questions I'd like to have?